been run by the lower Y-Tech design team. These are going to be the guys who are going to make the decision. Kind of listen to what you're saying. Give us the council, GKN, recommendations on what you want to do with your quality and your quality. So now that I listen to you through these sessions, primarily, there'll be other sessions as well. So we need to be capturing what your feedback is on what we are producing. The agenda has changed, as there are so many people here, it's more than what I thought it would be, so it's fantastic. We were going to have it in Moran, but unfortunately they had a tummy, so we've had to move this to Stoneham Hall, so thank you very much to Liz for helping out with that, Liz Rawlison. So we're going to have a quick introduction on the community workshop, then we're going to have a presentation from Nick Norton, which will be about an hour. He'll manage technical questions. I'm not quite sure if he wants to have questions throughout or at the end. I'll let him work that one out. Then in your groups around the tables that you are in, got facilitators on each of the tables, and they will be assessing, well, capturing your feedback on what's acceptable and not acceptable of the scenarios that they've put in front of you. Again, these scenarios are not options. They're just a starting point for us to start having a conversation. That will happen before and after dinner. We'll have dinner for about 40 minutes, and then after we've done that bit of feedback, we'll get the design committee just to get a bit of a general roundup of what your feedback has been, what their probably about 3 or 5 highlights are, and then we'll get Robin back up here, and I will close the meeting for today and then tell you about what the next one is in August. Okay? So why are we here? So the previous meeting we had was actually in May. We were planning on having one in June, but the weather gods were against us, and so we cancelled that in June 19th. So this is the first one that we're actually communicating. We're going to be able to have a conversation with you as to what scenarios are about. In May we had a discussion about outcomes, what the outcomes for the catchment should be. We've come up with, from those two meetings that were held in May, around the walls, there's some final outcomes that the zoning committee have come up with your feedback included. So one of them, for example, is about highly reliable and secure irrigation. Another outcome for the catchment is supporting aquatic life and biodiversity. They do clash, and that's okay. But these are the outcomes that we're going to try and strive for, that you've said that are what you kind of want for your, what you want for your catchment. Those outcomes are on the walls for summer, so you can have a look at those at the moment. So, we've identified the outcomes. Now we're going to assist the zoning committee to make the recommendations, as I said before. All of these recommendations will give us direction on how the plan will be written and the proposed land and water plan as it's currently written. And this will be notified in June next year. So, section 15 of the land and water regional plan. This is the area that we're looking at, South Canterbury Streams. You've got from the entire catchment of the north down to Morven Drain at the very bottom. It includes obviously Wanana Lagoon and Waimate, and then you've also got the Hunter Hill in there as well. Quite a diverse range of landscapes and communities within one catchment. So we've got a lot of different values, a lot of different wants and stuff in this catchment. We've got to find out how to work all those together. If you work for Canton Mansion in May, you've seen this slide before. This is the timetable. So we've had the meeting, the first public meeting in May. feedback to the zone committee on what you think is acceptable and what is unacceptable of these three sub-scenarios. These sub-scenarios are not options, they are a discussion. It's a way of starting the discussion with you. And it's also, what's unacceptable about these solutions? We want to find out how you want to provide, turn those unacceptables into solutions. How do you change them from reds into greens? So for you to provide solutions to the design committee so that you can feel, to the design committee that you feel would help to make something that is unacceptable. Again, scenarios come to us to explore what is the future, what it might look like for everyone's values. If we did certain things, including minutes and plan, must accept best estimates. There are no crystal balls. We can do tons more research. There's no crystal balls. We don't know what's going to happen necessarily. Scenarios are not necessarily options. They are to inform your choices, to inform the design committee's choices of minutes. So the one we're looking at today is a status quo, so pre-any development. No development, you've got to imagine this catchment without any development. What's going on today? We've given you that document, we sent it out a wee while ago. Hopefully you've read it. We will do a presentation to go through that. And you can tell us what it looks like probably the next 10 years as it stands today. And then in August we'll look at scenario 2 and 3. I'm not going to go into this too much detail, I'm going to bring this up later on, but this is what scenario 1 is about. Again, pre-development, it's about what's in the land and what is planned at the moment. What, if, in a very, very short way, if there was plenty of water in the river, if there's more water in the river and less abstraction, that is scenario 1B, and if there was more water used, is 1C. Those are your three alternatives that we're exploring at the moment. And there's some assumptions, obviously, with any scenario that we get. Now, this is the A3 page that's in front of all the tables. This is where, on the very front, I want you to write down that right here. So I've got an attendance sheet. And if you haven't left your name and email address with me, just write that down on that sheet as well. That would be fantastic. Inside there, these are the questions we're going to be asking you. The first one is, so scenario 1A, there's a sheet for scenario 1A, scenario B, and scenario 1C. First question is, what's acceptable? What's unacceptable? And notice there's a big area down here for what's unacceptable, how can I turn it into a solution? We do want those solutions from you guys. We don't have them all. You guys live there, you tell us how to solve it. And again, that comes back to how to achieve these outcomes that have been agreed through previous community meetings and what the zoning committee have seen, have heard you guys say that you want for your catchment. So remember those outcomes. When you have a look at this, look at also the matrix. The matrix is on your table. That's a really quick and easy way of being able to understand what the results are from the technical document. That should be able to reads, but actually I'll probably leave it from yet. But have a look at those, use that when you're going through your facilitator, find out what you find unacceptable, and what you're unhappy with, and what you can do. Is everyone alright with that so far? Any questions? Okay. So there is tension. There are recreational users, there are abstractors. There are all sorts of people who use water in different ways, and they all have different values, and that is absolutely fine. So, but we need to find where a sustainable balance is between these different values and these different outcomes that have been up here. So we need to acknowledge it, and it's okay to have that tension, it's okay to not agree with everyone, but we need to work openly and cooperatively with everyone. Okay, so this is why we're sitting around the table. Need you to listen and learn and try and understand from everyone and to recognise that it's a bit of a gift and engagement process in here. You may not get everything you want, but maybe you can give something, but you may not lose everything if you gift just a little bit. So the tension's good, it's fine.
us some feedback from you guys on what you think about those future scenarios. Now, I've got all the team members listed up there. I'm not going to, a number of them are here today, and they might be able to help answer questions at the end. I'm not going to introduce them all, but there's the names of the people if anyone's interested in following up with any of them later on. Okay, so what I'm planning to do today is just give quite a high-level summary presentation. I know some of you here will be wanting to see maybe detailed technical information graphs and things like that. That's not what I'm going to do today. I'm planning to keep it quite high-level and just get the simple key messages. If anyone is interested in more technical detail, that's why we have, first of all, the overview report on the website. Also a number, I think there's 10 or so technical reports that contribute to that, and we'll give you more detail if you're that way inclined. So what I will point you to though, is that for the minimal amount of reading, for those of you who just want to read the minimum, the overview report on the website has an effective summary in it, which is just 2 pages long, and that contains all of the key messages that the technical team think come out of exploration of scenarios 1A and C. And what goes with that 2-page executive summary is this matrix, which you've all got a copy of in front of you. And the way this matrix works is that down the left hand side, this column here, we've got all the zone committee identified outcomes, all the things that we'd like to see, which include economic, social, cultural, and environmental industry, for example, none of them. Now in this column here, there's a list of technical indicators that the team can run technical assessments against, and which we feel will give a reasonable idea of the extent to which each of these outcomes can be achieved under a range of possible future scenarios. Again, obviously on the right hand side, we've got our future scenarios. Today we're just dealing with the first three, which is the reason only the first three are covered in. On the 21st of August, we'll fill in the remaining scenarios 2A and B, 3A and B. And so that we've seen a whole lot on the 21st of August. So just a little bit about the colour score. It's a 5-point system. And the way it works is that if we think that our assessment shows that there's almost certainly a scenario is going to achieve the zone committee outcome, it'll get a dark green. If we think it probably will achieve the outcome, it'll be a light green, possibly yellow, unlikely orange, and highly unlikely red. So now clearly there's a lot of simplification that goes into making that scoring assessment, and I'll take some responsibility for doing that in order to be able to present something fairly simple like this to you. Again, I just stress that the details are contained in the underlying reports. So before we get into it, and what I'm planning to do is I'll pretty much go through each of the sections of that summary matrix and just briefly explore the scoring across those three sub-scenarios. But before we do that, just a few points I'd like to make. I've already stressed that the summary matrix is a high-level comparison tool. The second point I'd like to make is that before we even get started, I think we need to accept the reality that perfection everywhere for all of those values is not possible. We shouldn't expect to see dark greens all the way down any of those columns. The reason for that, of course, is that we're in an area where we're trying to utilise land and water resources as well as achieve environmental outcomes. And resource use has effects. There's no two ways about it. What we're trying to do is we're trying to fix reds. We're trying to eliminate as many reds as we can, and we're trying to increase the number of greens that we get through time. And for some of those indicators, it might take a considerable amount of time to get greens, but that's okay. We want to try and map out a path, and if it takes time, that's alright. Final point, David. Next point down there, Mary's already made, just the benefit of bringing the effective philosophy to this process. And then the last point there is the idea, hopefully you can see, is that once the matrix is completed, you can look across it and you can explore what the best bits So what I'm going to do now is I'll go through in the same order and as we've gone through in the overview report, which is on the website, which means I'll deal with the social and economic stuff first, stream rivers and groundwater second, and then my own and good. I'll just make the point that cultural matters are relevant for recourse for all of these things. There's no rank implied by this order, it's just simply a pragmatic way to go through it. And those three areas of course are related to the three priority outcomes that are listed up on the board and that are in the left hand column of the matrix on your table. So we'll get into it with the social and economic stuff first.
Just a question, Naomi. Can you people have your seat? Can I shift the chairs around so we get a bit better with the screen?
People hear me okay? I'm talking about that. So cut straight to the chase. We're talking about land and water use. What do we currently have in this project area? We currently have land use is currently dominated by sheep and beef, about 60%, followed by dairy and then arable, forestry, horticulture and agriculture making up the last bit. In terms of the currently irrigated area, we've got about, I think it's about 40% dairy, 30% sheep and beef, about 23% arable, 40% agriculture making up the difference. Now, in terms of what economic benefit does the primary sector bring, the primary sector contains the village project area to bring currently, and this is economic work done by Simon Harris. I'm not going to go into these blocks in any detail, but just draw out a couple of things. Currently, this project area, the primary industry in this project area contributes about $440 million annually to regional GDP. It's about 770 jobs locally, 3,800 odd jobs regionally when you take into account flow-on employment. Now the thing about this is these numbers probably don't mean a lot to most of us and because we've got nothing to compare them against. On the 21st of August we will have something to compare these against because we will insert into these plots what the economic contribution is, employment contribution is, the scenarios to them. For now we don't have that. So all we can do really to make some kind of an assessment of whether those numbers are good, bad or otherwise is have a look. What the proportion of currently irrigable area is that's actually irrigated. If we do that, this map shows the light green area is our estimate of the currently irrigated land, or able to be irrigated, or has consents to irrigate, and that's about 28,000 hectares currently. Under the future scenario that we're going to get into on the 21st of August, the Hunter Downs and Waiho Downs, being implemented, that would be able to fill in the dark green area, which brings us up approximately doubles the irrigated area up to about 55,000 hectares. So clearly only a part of the land production potential is currently being realised, and we can make some sort of a comparison of that with the Canterbury Water Management Strategy Target 7, which is all about increasing the irrigated area, provided that can be done within environmental limits. So clearly there's only that potential further irrigated area that can be done within environmental limits. In terms of comparing sub-scenarios 1A, 1B and 1C for economics, sub-scenario 1A is approximately the current situation in terms of the current minimum flows on all of your in-catchment rivers in the current consented allocation on all of your in-catchment rivers. Compare that to sub-scenario B, which is where we've got higher minimum flows and smaller allocations. That situation results in a significant loss of irrigated area and in reliability of supply, and that would have some significant impact on economic and also related social outcomes, which is the area where Taylor contributes to this assessment. Sub-scenario 1C, on the other hand, which has lower minimum flows and maintains the current allocation, would result in a minor increase of irrigated area social applications in the area currently in under scenario 1, and this applies to scenarios 1A, 1B and 1C fairly equally. There's currently weak growth but low unemployment. Population is likely to remain stable but aging. Social services are likely to remain stable at current levels. School roles are at best steady but decline is likely as the population ages. In terms of drinking water, our technical assessment is that the deep groundwater is likely to retain its high quality under scenarios 1A and C, and that's the source of the Waimate supply. Shallow groundwater and surface water will see a small increase in the risk of nitrate concentration decreasing, and also pathogens, microorganisms. We'll cover that in a little bit more detail later. And that small increase is as a result of the intensification we assume would occur, even though there's no significant new water coming into the catchment. It's just based on intensification within the existing irrigation area with existing water. In terms of recreation, water-based recreation, scenario 1B, with its high minimum flows and small allocations, some more water left in the river, is clearly going to be better than the current situation 1A, which is in turn better than 1C. In terms of the cultural and manapenua effects, I'm not going to say a lot about this, clearly I'm not the right person to be doing that, and manapenua will speak for themselves when the time is right, and that was going to be today, but for the reasons that Meredith mentioned, not, possibly on the 21st of August. What I can say though is that manapenua is certainly actively involved in both leading and participating in this process, both by the fact that they represent on the zoning committee and contributing to these public meetings. And we have another breakout group where we're liaising with them individually as well. Clearly, Waihoa water system is highly significant to Waihoa Rauwhenua. The Waihoa River itself is named, of course, for the sweetness of the Hau Eel, 850 years AD, quite some time ago. Key issues for Manawhenua are the need to address environmental flows and water quality pollution, and also restore Mahangakai and Wahitapu sites. And those targets are pretty clearly spelled out in the Canterbury Water Management Strategy. And apply to the whole region. Specifically for this project area also is the need to maintain quality Waihoa Tauhara Reserve. So I'll talk briefly about that a little bit later on. In general, from a cultural manapenua perspective, about speaking for them, we have the opportunity to do that. In general terms, I think it's fair to say that scenario 1B certainly maps their aspirations better than 1A. Which is in turn better than 1C, and I can say that because scenario 1B was in part designed based on input from one in terms of the flow preferences that they have for the streams in the area. So I want to wrap up that whole economic and social bit in one slide, and this would be it. And this is just the top section of rows in the summary matrix you've got in front of you. And the first thing I'll say about this is that the top set of rows here is the economic stuff. And we've elected, and I'll put my hand up and say it was me, to score the economic stuff with a yellow right bang in the middle. And the reason for that is that clearly there's untapped potential. There's only half of the current irrigated area that's currently irrigated, so there's room for further economic growth. But the current economic situation is also not too bad. It's not in dire straits, and arguably that would justify being given an orange or a red perhaps. So it's yellow, it's bang in the middle. Slight reduction in the economic indicators under scenario 1B, because we've got the high minimum flows, and slight increase, although not very much of an increase under scenario 1C. Across all these other indicators, there's not much difference between scenarios except for fishing activity and recreational stuff. We're clearly more water left in the river under scenario 1B is going to be better. And the current So we'll move on then now to the streams, rivers and groundwater. And we'll start with the rivers and the streams. And we'll start first just with the water quantity side of that, so the ecological flow, so we'll leave quality for a minute. Just a reminder that we're of course talking about both the inland hillbed rivers as well as the spring-fed streams near the coast. We know that these intermittent hillbed rivers go dry each summer in the mid-reaches. We know that that's a natural situation, but it's undoubtedly, in that situation creates flow stress, obviously, for things that live in the river, into the in-stream ecology. And we know that that is made, even though it's a natural situation, it is made worse the more water we take from those rivers and the shallow groundwater that's connected to them. You don't need to be able to read this table, it's just to show you the type of information that's available in the technical reports if you want to go there and get into that little bit of detail. To show you that we have gone to the extent of assessing the amount of habitat that would be likely available for a number of key species under each of these scenarios, so that we can compare the relative merits between them. It's not just about habitat, we've also taken account of flow variability, flushing, pressure and flushing flows, having enough water for fish passage, while acknowledging the natural situation of the drying in the bridges, and temperature and dissolved oxygen. And so when we consider all of those things, and there's quite some detail in the technical report if you want it, but here's the one slide summary of it. And there shouldn't be too many surprises there that, in general, scenario 1B, which has the higher minimum flows and the higher implications, there's a few more greens than the current situation. The current situation is moderate to poor in terms of ecological flows, and scenario 1C would make it a little bit worse. Moving on to groundwater quantity, quick reminder that we're talking about two different groundwater resources. We're talking about a shallow aquifer, shallow gravels that in most areas or many areas are hydraulically connected to flowing rivers, and then there's deep groundwater resource down in the canyons and gravels. So we've had a bit of a look at what the increase in demand has been for water irrigation over about the last 40 years. In general, we can see it was boxed at one for each groundwater zone. Years 1970 to 2012 on the bottom, and increasing demand. The towers on the graph, as you can see, particularly in the last 10 years, there's been a steady increase from 1970, in the last 10 years, increasing demand for water irrigation. And in recent years, that's been taken up more from groundwater as the surface water resources generally recognised as being fully allocated. In terms of the groundwater resource as it currently stands, the way that it can currently sets its allocation limits on the groundwater resource has set limits in a way that means that the groundwater is largely allocated in this particular area. So you can see in that bio, 96% allocated, it's just a smidge left there, pretty much bang on allocated within the key. About 40% over allocated in the hook, pretty much allocated in the Waimate. There's a bit of capacity still in the Waiho groundwater zone, but of course that's the zone that's supplied by the Northern Grenada scheme, so there's demand for that resource there. So there's not actually a lot to say about differences between 1A, 1B, 1C for groundwater quantity. There's very little difference, just a smidgen more groundwater level to support wetlands in the scenario 1B, where we get higher minimum flows and smaller allocations. There's not a lot in it. At most, maybe about 20 litres per second in some of the waterways. And in the scenario 1C, slightly worse. The key point being that as it currently stands, the groundwater resource is largely allocated. So, moving on to groundwater quality, and in technical terms this one gets a little bit complicated, but so a key issue that we're concerned about with groundwater quality when we're talking about land use and intensification and further irrigation. nitrate, nitrogen and leaching rates from the current Canterbury lookup table overseas. So it's a patch for those of you that, that means something to you. There are the technical stuff going on in this area. We've used that kind of information to make predictions about what the nitrate concentration will be in shallow groundwater currently and under future scenarios, and also the drainage and the nitrate loads. In the results, I'm not going to go through this in detail, but just to show you that the results are broken up in sub-catchment and in the project area. And in general, under scenario 1, and this applies equally to 1A and B and 1C, there's an increase in nitrate concentrations in shallow groundwater of around about 14%, it varies across the sub-catchments, around about 14%, and that's compared to current. And that's just a function of the intensification that we've assumed in that scenario that will appear on both irrigated and non-irrigated ground, even without any further water coming into the catchment.
Yeah, there's a question that's coming in.
Yeah, I'm just really talking about tons of nitrogen per catchment getting to the groundwater, and then you're talking about overseer modelling.
Yep.
Are you assuming that if a farm's leaching figure from overseer, which is too below the root zone, you can change completely between getting below the root zone and actually making it into groundwater, are you assuming it all goes into the groundwater?
Yeah, we're using lookup table and overseer information to estimate what's lost below the root zone and what's lost below the root zone, and we're assuming makes its way through and on down the catchment. We have allowed for just, you'll see in a minute from the surface water section, is it allowed for some attenuation of that. So concentration in the streams are a little bit lower.
So we're going to take a look. Yeah, you've got to be a little bit careful going there. You know, it's very much a lot of such a broken zone and you can quite a long way down to ground.
Yeah, you do. There's lots of controls and lots of assumptions. I don't want to get into that today.
Yeah.
Today is mostly about quantities. So scenario 1A, 1B and 1C are about the quantity of flows. It's the 21st of August. Scenario 2. Say that this table is that in terms of the shallow groundwater, we're interested in drinking water, and so the number that we use to compare with the drinking water is this drinking water standard maximum acceptable value, 11.3 milligrams per litre. And so the colour scoring system here shows that it gets a green if the concentration is below half of that NAV, which is your sort of conservative. It's higher than half NAV, it's still below NAV, then it gets an orange, which is just kind of a watch, keep an eye out space, and then it's red, it's indicated red because it's going higher than the MA3. There's the two places there where the model is suggesting that it might go higher than the MA3. I will say, stress that this one here this morning, right? We've got suspicions about the way that that was also dealing with the water dock irrigation in that area, and we've got quite a number of monitoring boards in that area that are well below that, and it's quite possible that what's happening is that the irrigation races and or contribution from the Lower Waitaki River to the groundwater in that area is still leaching nitrate and keep as well as they can. So don't make a big song and dance about that.
And move on, and we're talking about
another question here.
If you're modelling an air bed status quo, how are you getting a 40% increase?
Okay, so.
Nick, can you please repeat the question?
Right, so the question was, if we're modelling a status quo, how are we getting a 14% increase? That's a good question. Scenario 1 is not the current situation today. Scenario 1 is looking 10 to 20 years out, assuming that only the currently allocated water that's available in the catchment, but that intensification continues to occur in utilising that water. So we're assuming that there's going to be in our the assumptions that we've made for scenario 1, and they're spelled out in, what, in some detail in the appendices of the technical report, we're looking at what happens if no more water comes into this expect would happen, if no more work comes into the catchment and everybody does what was anticipated within the current proposed limits of the land and water regional plan.
If something else doesn't change, then how, why would the status quo change? So if you're going to get into intensification, you must have some other control that comes into that happen, such as additional water. And in some of the irrigated areas from your bores, you find out that if you add water, then you stop that from happening.
I'm not sure I totally understand the question.
Well, from an irrigation standpoint, the bores show that if you add water at 100% reliability or somewhere around that, then the uptake of nutrients is a hell of a lot better than you don't need the kitchen. So it needs to go yellow.
Okay, look, I don't want to get into this here because essentially it's going to make a big difference to the messages that are coming out of today.
So the intensification he's talking about is a forbidden operation. We've looked at historical trends in intensity within an operation, so increase in stocking rate, increase in new pasture species, and we're expecting that to trend on into the future, and we've allowed that to happen up to the rules, to the level of rules allowed in the current planning. It's not new water, it's existing operations.
So the farms are even more expected to not going up for nothing in the future. Well, there must be some plant varieties out there that I don't know about.
There has been intensification and I'll talk to you about it afterwards, but there is still capacity for intensification within the current system. So if you look at the difference between the average operation and the top operation, there's considerable room for further intensification.
So Nick, can you take over there? Just so we can follow that through.
Okay, look, in terms of summary matrix level comparison between sub-scenarios when it comes to groundwater quality. First point is that for the deep groundwater, we anticipate another change to another increase in nitrate, and we expect to see good drinking quality when it comes to nitrate across all three sub-scenarios. In terms of the shallow groundwater, this can be cut clearly. Some areas of the project area which are not perfect, but they don't deserve an oil red either. In terms of nitrate and shallow groundwater, and there's no difference across the scenarios. In terms of microorganisms in surface and shallow groundwater, certainly is currently at risk if you were to drink that water untreated. No doubt about that. And that risk would continue across the other scenarios. Certainly, if you were to drink that microorganisms, surface groundwater and shallow groundwater needs to be treated. And currently, it is in all the accounts advice. When it comes to surface water quality, so the rivers and streams, leave one over for a minute. So we've taken the little increase in nitrate concentration on the shallow groundwater, and we've taken the relative difference between the model current and the model scenario one, and we've applied that to our known measured concentrations in the streams. So what that does is it allows for an attenuation factor in the catchment. It says somewhere between the nitrate being lost below the red zone and making its way down the catchment, there is attenuation going on. We don't know exactly where it is, but there are things like denitrification happening in some areas and uptake of purifying plants in the rivers, which means that the concentrations that we actually see in the streams are a little bit lower. So that's the basis we've used to come out with our numbers. When we drop those numbers, then it's David Keller who's done this work. We then compete those numbers with various national guidelines that are out there, nitrate toxicity criteria. And we've made predictions of use of value and nitrate toxicity, biodiversity, in terms of the inferred groups, situation. That blocks scenario 1A, that blocks scenario 1B, that blocks scenario 1C. And for each scenario, we've listed the rivers that the assessment shows yes would meet that. Orange if it's at risk, red if it currently doesn't meet that. And then the same pattern goes through scenarios 1A, 1B, 1C. And if, without looking at the detail, you can just stand back and you can see that with the high flows in the rivers, there's a little bit less risk in scenario 1B, a little bit better in scenario 1C as worse. Okay, so without needing to read all the detail, that's the key message. Because one of those tables is Springfield streams as well. So you can go there to see what's going on in your particular stream. The words in here are each individual stream site that we're out to access. Just a reminder what we're talking about. I put this up in May for those of you who are here. So verifying algae, the stuff that grows in rivers and causes this slime. So this is the Lauawaha River in January earlier this year. So that's the stuff that I'm talking about. And then in this photo, this is like a dark coloured slime bacteria, and that's chlamydia, which can be toxic if your dogs eat it. Right, so that's the stuff that I'm talking about. And the one slide summary of all of that is, verified and verified communities, we currently definitely don't meet healthy outcomes. And it's not currently in the scenario 1A. Things get a little bit better when we increase program 1B and go back to reading the scenario 1C. Nitrate toxicity, we're actually currently not too bad. All the rivers actually meet the 9% level of protection in toxicity guidelines. So I've scored this based on that 90%. Scenario 1B is a little bit better, so this up arrow, I should have said that earlier, shouldn't I? This up arrow is to indicate where there's a further improvement in scenario 1B compared to 1A, but not so much as to justify colour change. And the downward arrow is the other way around. All the other things, yeah, so this other block of things here is all about the vertebrates that live in the stream, and they provide the food, fish, and also the suitability of waterway for contact recreation. And currently orange, it's not in a great space right now, as you can see from quite a few sites, as you can see from those photographs. A bit of benefit, a bit of improvement under scenario 1B, and things get worse if they happen under a couple of years in scenario 1C. So we're going to move on to one other lagoon now. And first of all, we'll just start with the coastal crises, the level and opening regime. And talk about this briefly in May, but we've made the assumption across all of these scenarios, and that includes 2 and 3 that we'll talk about later in August. We're going to assume that control at the box, at the mouth, continues on as it has in the past. We don't want to cloud the differences between scenarios by shooting anything different there. The other reason for that is that everybody we've talked to so far, and tell me if anyone here doesn't agree with this, all the feedback we've had so far is that most people are pretty happy with the performance of the box through time. And we'd like to see that continue, both in terms of the assisting with flood management, but also the function that it provides for allowing fish such as eels and flounders and other fish to come in and complete their life cycles and populate the Lauawaha River and the Waimea again. So there are clearly some maintenance issues associated with the box that need to be resolved. That's going to need to be part of this process that we talked to the Zoning Committee about. But we think that all things point to trying to maintain something similar to what we have currently down there. So summarise that in matrix format. So in terms of opening regimes for eels, green, no difference between scenarios. Similarly for managing drainage and flooding, I know there is a certain period of it. Problem floating down there, but in general terms, people seem to be happy with the way the box helps them out there. And we'll see it continue. sediment, as well as nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, as well as microorganisms. Probably primarily the first thing, a number of microorganisms will be going for the food system. So in terms of the nutrients, one oligoin is currently highly enriched with nutrients, both nitrogen and phosphorus, and technical area of technical lake science. One of the technical indicators that we use to describe that situation is this thing called the trophic level index, the TLI score. So it's a scale from 1 through to greater than 7, where 1 is very low nutrient, clear, clean water. Lake Benmore is somewhere up in the order of between 2 and 3. 7 is highly nutrient enriched. Currently, one of the lagoon is sitting at about 6.5, and we predict that to be more or less continued under scenario 1. The current ECAN target in the proposed neighbourhood regional plan is for a TLI score of 6, so that requires some improvement to get back to that point. And that's the reason, in fact, that under the proposed neighbourhood regional plan at the moment, the one on our catchment is considered to be over allocated with regard to the nutrients. Okay, so that fits the situation there. When it comes to the risk of nuisance and toxic blooms, this is an aerial photograph from a helicopter which shows we don't get many reported nuisance blooms, citing bacterial blooms in Wainana, but there's been one or two, and this was one that was spotted, this little green slip that's formed on the surface, and that one did apparently have a species in it that is toxic at times. We have another set of national guidelines, or draft guidelines, which gives us a method for estimating what the risk is of these things happening in the lakes. And it depends on the depth of the lake, the amount of nutrients going into it, and also the exposure to wind. And wind is one of the things that saves one of the lagoon from having a worse score than this, because the wind is currently breaking up these blooms and causing more to mix. Currently, when we run through that, it's the same as it's in the guidelines. We're going to sit around about this mid to moderate risk of blooms space, and we put it back to stay the same on the scenario. So, to summarise that, in terms of the summary matrix, it's not flash from a water quality perspective currently. It's got a red. It doesn't mean that the current proposed downwind regional plan 10 was for. We get a little bit of improvement under scenario 1B just because of the increased tributary place coming in, but it's not enough to really improve things significantly. And we get a little bit worse under scenario 1C. So the Wainana and the Taita Reserve, I talked about this briefly before, so this was presented last year. And just a reminder for those of you who aren't clear about where it is, that it takes in the whole Wainana lagoon, as well as the all of the major tributaries up to the point where they intersect with State Highway 1. And of course, what we're interested in there is trying to provide for a quality topographic reserve, so that means sustaining the fish populations, and in particular the tuna, but also Pākehā flounder and the Enanga populations. And so if we score that in terms of the summary matrix, and just note that this is a scoring based on the flow related aspects, because we've already dealt with all the quality stuff. In terms of the flow stuff, scenario 1 of these scores better because we've got more water within the river and the tributaries coming in, and those tributaries, that scenario 1B, those flows that we've got are probably not too many preferences, so we get a better score there. And worse under scenario 1C. So, to wrap that all up in terms of a summary, to try and get all that on one page, that's what you get, the summary matrix up on the table. And hopefully, that's of some use that you can look at the stuff and run your eye down and go, which of these indicators in my last just two slides, I think. We have two pages worth of key messages in the overview report, but if I was to even summarise those further into just two slides, this is what it would be. First one is that about half the arable area is currently irrigated. Second one is that irrigation growth is currently constrained by water supply, as well as the proposed annual regional ground quality limits. Thirdly, the ecology of rivers and streams is naturally flow stressed in summer, but that's without doubt exacerbated by the current irrigation surface and shallow groundwater connected takes. Scenario 1A is approximately the current situation with regard to flow and irrigation limits. Scenario 1B, which is the higher minimum flow and lower allocation, is better for ecology, but very negative in economic and related social effects. Scenario 1C, with its lower minimum flows, and in fact the same allocation actually being up there, is the least likely to meet sustainability tests under the RMA, and it only gives a small economic social gain. The water quality contaminants are a key issue that we've got to grapple with, and we'll put into that a bit more later in August. The scenarios 2 and 3. Getting everybody up to good management practice on the farm, as well as all of the really great initiatives that are already underway with the one on the restoration project, will definitely help. By thinking of habitat and the wood quality stuff, but we do still need to go through the process of considering nitrogen, certainly nitrogen and possibly phosphorus limits in terms of the regional planning process. Deep groundwater quality is good, but shallow groundwater quality does decrease with the intensification of use, thus induce nitrate and microorganisms. For water quality of rivers and streams, scenario 1B is clearly better than 1A, which is better than 2 and 1C. But use of value are going to remain a risk across all the scenarios, and it's just a function of the type of rivers that we've got and the stresses that we're under. Well, now that the water quality currently doesn't meet the proposed standard water regional plan environmental objectives, the TOI score of 6, as well as occasionally breaches the temperature and result of oxygen. And that's the case under all of these sub-scenarios. So we need to think about what we can do about that. And that's it for that. And then, as Meredith said, asking you guys what you think.